Sid Rosenberg, mornings only on 640 Sports.
It's our good buddy, Lionel. Good morning, Lionel.
I love you. I got to tell you something. You are so desperately needed here. And as you mentioned before, and as you presage, as you were Vatic, as you read the entrails of the beast, as you were Pythonic, and said the future of industry and radio, whatever, things are going to change drastically. And New York desperately, drastically needs somebody of your magnitude.
Sid Rosenberg, mornings only on 640 Sports. Sports.
Sister Christian, oh, the time has come, and you know that you're the only one to say. Okay, where you going, what you looking for? You know those boys don't wanna play no more with you. It's true.
Right now, I can hear the firecrackers going off. What a great scene. Remember the movie? This song playing in the background. Drug dealer in his bathrobe. Firecrackers. He's setting them up all over the place. Three guys sitting on the couch. One of those guys, of course, Mark Wahlberg, Night Ranger, Sister Christian. What movie am I looking for, Eric Langell?
I'm going to say...
Dirk Diggler.
Boogie Nights.
There you go. Bang. Hello. Boogie Nights. Anyway, you heard the little rejoin there. We love this next guest. I believe he's the smartest guy we ever bring on this show. I really believe that's true. And he's funny and smart and opinionated, and we love him. So here he is, our friend Lionel, live in New York City. Good morning, Lionel.
Before we get to the top story, let's talk about one of the things that makes you one of the great radio talents of all time, everybody. Mr. Sid Rosenberg. First of all, the longest bumper music ever.
Yes.
You wait beyond. I can see some PD saying, go into it!
Oh, my God. It's funny you say that.
We're going to pay royalties! What are you doing?
I've been yelled about that 1,000 times.
Oh,
I
can hear it now.
Yes.
I had a guy one time who said, never play lyrics. Right. Why? You don't. It's in my book. That's what you do. And also, you should do... Remember when KTEL said, KTEL presents the songs of, you know, trucking songs, Red Sylvine, and, you know, and Yakety Sax, and compilations you would never, ever want. Sid Rosenberg, songs you don't want to admit you love. Every song you play is like, damn, I love that song. I went to the night to the Cutting Room, by the way, which I'm going to be this... Not that it matters to you guys, but Saturday night at the Cutting Room in... doing my stand-up and outspoken word here. And I was there the other night watching this a tremendous birthday party for a friend of ours, May Pang.
Yes.
And lo and behold, who gets up but Mark Hudson? Remember the Hudson brothers?
I do, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Mark Hudson is a big, famous producer, whatever. He gets up and he does two numbers. Hot Legs by Rod Stewart and Tush by ZZ Top.
Right.
And you would think, first of all, I don't like those songs. I love those songs. You don't admit. You don't recognize. In fact, that should be your billboard. Sid Rosenberg, admit it. In your heart, you know he's right. But you love the guy. You want to hate him. You listen to him, you say, this guy cannot possibly know what's going on. But he does, in a strange and quirky way.
Right.
It's been too long, Sid.
You had
everybody else.
You know, I'll tell you a funny story. It's a God's honest truth.
I'll be the judge of that. Go ahead.
All right, you be the judge of that. One of my dear friends in the business said yesterday, he goes, this is at 12:30. Now, I had booked you at 11:30 yesterday morning. An hour later, he said, where's Lionel? I said, it's amazing that I just booked the guy an hour ago. But I will tell you, he's not the only one that you have become a fan favorite, and it has been too long. I apologize. But we're thrilled to death you're back this morning. We are very, very happy. Very happy.
Well, Well, you know, it's too big. You know, I know you're sucking up to all these New York people.
That's right.
You know, you can make a big move. I understand that. I'm just, who am I? You know, what am I? I'm the future, my friend. Let's talk about a couple of realities, shall we? First of all, you got to understand something. I want you to imagine today. I want all of your legions of listeners to imagine this thought experiment. You're meeting somebody either from another planet or another country. And you say, let me explain to you Americans. And that's a tough one, too, because where? North, east, west, south, what age group? But let's talk about the politically, quote, politically savvy American, the American voter. Let me just explain to you that. American voter, the guy who watches American media, the guy who watches mainstream media, that kind of guy, the people that you victimize and exploit daily on the Sid Rosenberg fun and frolic hour. Now, what we need to do is you got to understand something. Americans don't know anything about anything except sports. You know, we just had this Mets thing. It was tragic. And Mets are, it's funny, Mets are like the Democrats. Mets are Bernie Sanders. Mets are the working guy. Mets are just, you know, the Yankees are, you know, Fox News and Wall Street. And, you know, of course they're going to win, except when they don't. It's the most amazing thing in the world. And everybody knew every statistic about the Mets. It's the most amazing. People who didn't know, who couldn't find their ass with two hands and a map, all of a sudden were saying, well, you know, the Mets, 1986, 02, they always lose to it. Now, they knew every stat, everything, every nuance of the game. And I thought, you know, if only they knew about politics, specifically history, like they do sports, things would be better. If we could apply that genius of sports analysis to what's going on, nobody would be bamboozled by this nonsense. Because one thing sports people do is they read. They really love to read stuff.
Well, let me just say this, too. You're right, they do read, and I know you'll agree with this. You can also quantify sports because most sports can be proved on a statistical basis, which politics really can't now, can it?
No, I disagree, because there's other aspects of sports, too. For example, there's what happens on the field or the gridiron or whatever it is, but then there's what happens in the front office and what happens with the NFL and the owners and PEDs and collective bargaining, and there's so many nuances. There's nothing that the sports fan can't understand. There's nothing beyond – let me give you an example. Everybody says, you know, I was on a crosstown bus yesterday, which, by the way, is worth the price of admission, right? So I see this guy who's one of these, he's a car salesman, ex-Wall Streeter, perpetually tanned or keratinemic. He has either, he's bilious, he has a bilirubin problem, his liver is functioning, or he has spray-on tan, one of the two. So he says, you know, I got to tell you something. The biggest problem we got here is your ISIS. You know, ISIS, these Muslims, these fanatical Islam. And this is his thing. Whenever he sees me, this is his top of mind. I said, man, it's great you say that. I said, you know where ISIS comes from, huh? Wouldn't it be nice to know a little bit about ISIS? Wouldn't you like to know a little bit about that? Are they American League, National League? You know, where are they from? Who are they? Where did they just pop out of nowhere? What, ISIS? When you have the ISIS crisis, they from 2007 to when did they start? They've been around? Who started ISIS? I don't know. Why don't we ask? Let's go back. What's the difference between ISIS, IS, ISIL, Daesh, Khorasan, al-Nusra Front, Boko Haram, al-Qaeda, AQI? What's the difference? Jesus, I don't know. I never knew there were that many people. That's right. That's right. Remember in the old days when you would watch it was a soap opera, and all of a sudden they would say, the guiding light, or as the world turns, maybe you don't remember this, but they'll say, playing the part today of John Stewart
Sid Rosenberg. Yes. By the way,
playing the part of...
Yeah.
Well, that's terrorism.
Yeah.
Playing the part of Al-Qaeda this week is IS.
Right.
And as soon as you figure out IS, here's my favorite. Ask people what ISIL is. Ask about the Levant. Oscar Levant? Americans know nothing.
Yeah.
There's a wonderful site which I commend to your listeners. It's voltairenet.org. And there's a wonderful piece from as early as 2014. And Saudi Arabia owns. Saudi Arabia, okay? These are the guys. This is Saudi Arabia is the Al Sharpton of international terrorism. Nothing sticks to them. Nothing. They have redacted testimony 9/11. Their fingerprints are all over it. Nobody Teflon, Kevlar, nothing sticks. It's amazing. But in Al Arabiya, Prince Abdul Rahman Al-Faisal is the ruler of ISIS. And his brother, Turkey Al-Faisal, the Saudi ambassador of the United States and the UK. It goes back. These are the guys. Let me see if I can give you an analogy. There was a while back in New York where all of a sudden we had bed bugs. Jesus, bed bugs. I said, what bed bugs? And then there was this little dog named Roscoe, this beagle that it was probably one dog or whatever, but they would bring Roscoe. Hey, where's Roscoe? And every ad was for this dog who would come in and sniff your apartment or your home to look for bed bugs. People said, where the hell did bed bugs come from? Bed bugs. Now we have rats. We got crime. Now we got bed bugs. Don't let the bed bugs bite. Seemingly innocuous historically, but now all of a sudden a problem. You know who started this, in my opinion? The exterminators. They started spreading these things around. It's business. ISIS is the perfect foil. ISIS, ISIL, IS, FSA, Syria. We put these people in. We cause a problem, and then we say, whoa, now we got to have regime
Let me ask you something, because I've got a friend of mine who, she's a very smart girl. Let me preface it by saying that, and very politically savvy. Her name is Lauren. And she watches all these debates, Lionel, and she reads everything, and she loves Donald Trump. She believes that Donald Trump loves America more than anybody else, any of these candidates, and that he's the one that could control ISIS. As far as she's concerned, The only thing we have to worry about, it's not taxes, it's not the economy at home, it's none of these social issues, it's ISIS. I tell her she's out of her mind. You tend to agree.
Let me give you a better example. Tell your friend, see, she's believing this nonsense. She's believing, that's like Lauren saying, the reason why people play professional sports is for the love of the game. What are you ignorant? What are you talking about? Let me do this one. You know, years ago, there was a great comedian, Bill Hicks. And Bill Hicks was a prophet, along with George Carlin. And Bill Hicks does this thing. He did this thing, which was very, very famous, in which he talks about, by the way, not that this helps, my Twitter handle. I got to promote this social media stuff. At Lionel Media. At Monkey Tail. You know what that at sign is? Look up that one. What is that thing called? What is that, an ampersand? No, the at, the A? There's a name for that. Anyway, Lionel Media.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so Bill Hicks says that he has this idea that when you become the president of the United States, you go into the Oval Office, and to show you how old this routine is, somebody comes in and says, Mr. President, let me show you something. And they pull down the projector screen, and they close the drapes, and you see a scene from Dallas, November 22nd, 1963, from a position, from a vantage point nobody's ever seen before, from, dare I say, the assassins, or assassins, plural, point of view. And you think, who took this picture? It's as though the assassin took this photo. The lights go on, they look at the president, they say, any question, okay? Now, that's the first thing every president knows going in. Imagine this, Mr. Rosenberg, President, Mr. President, sit down. You're now the president. Here's the key to the executive washroom. Here's the Secret Service. Here's your code word. Let me explain to you a few things. In fact, your predecessor may tell you this. Then, you know, when you pass off, here is the rule. Number one, whatever you said during the course of your election, don't worry about it. We're going to write the script for you. You're an actor. This is Hamlet. It's been written. And you can be interpret it differently. You can be a different actor, different style, but it is written. And here is the following script for the next 15 years. And you're going to follow this. Remember, you're going to follow this. The first thing is, let me tell you who runs the military: NATO, not you. No. You're going to sign off on stuff. We're going to tell you what to do. Mr. President Rosenberg, let me tell you what happened. Russia is now heating up. The Cold War is a hot war. Let me explain to you a couple of things about these people. First of all, you know that in our current, in our present media, these guys have always been the evil. Remember remember Boris Badenoff, you know,
sure,
Spy
sure.
versus Spy?
Yeah.
Have you seen A Bridge of Spies, this new Tom Hanks movie? More of the you know, the dirty Russian scary. And then recently there's a show, Trumbo, about the blacklisting, the Cold War. Understanding what these people, in the 20th century, in 1917 and 1991, the Soviet Union their country basically collapsed twice. They got a weird perspective. So right after 1991, here comes Bill Clinton. And Bill Clinton decides, I'm going to put NATO all around your border. I'm going to put weapons defense systems, and I'm going to heat this thing up. Now imagine, we, the United States, sees a contingent of Chinese soldiers, Chinese battalions, and batteries of high-tech weapons along the Mexican and or Canadian border. What do you think they'd be screaming on Fox News to do? What do you think Chuck Todd would be doing? What do you think people would be saying? Mr. President, you got to do something. They're making a fool out of us. So what did NATO do? We go there. For the first time ever, we have a Cold War that's going on right now that is now going to switch hot very, very fast. And you see, this isn't ISIS. This isn't Grenada. This isn't Gaddafi. These are tactical nuclear weapons. And you've got people in our country, the Kagans, the Newlands, you've got Petraeus and Allen, the Bonapartists, the ones who were running the military show. And to President Obama's credit, he has fought off this let's go into Syria nonsense. And now we got something which is even more interesting. This morning we learned that there are F-15C, these planes, which we have sent to Syria and the Turkish border. Now, Turkey with Erdogan, that's a guy nobody. We don't understand anything about this guy. Not really sure. Who is he? Ahmet Erdogan? No, Erdogan. What happens is this is now a fighter jet that has only air-to-air missiles. When you have Russian jets and now American jets flying over Syria, God forbid something goes wrong. God forbid. And there are people, McCain, Lindsey Graham, the Pentagon, the Hawks. You know who Victoria Nuland is? You ever hear that name? Kagan, Institute for War, all of these NGOs, all of these Hawks. These guys, they make Dr. Strangelove look like, you know, Mr. Rogers. So that's going on right here. Now, what happens is all we need to do is drum up this thing about ISIS. Now, you mentioned Donald Trump before. Let me tell you something. Donald Trump is the guy who, if you were sitting around the day room at Creedmoor, you know, the big psych hospital, you would say, I think he's the least crazy. I really do. He has said some things which are so antagonistic to the status quo. I kind of like it. He has one of the most rational foreign policy theories I've seen. He's very, very good about that. Now, whether it's Donald Trump, Ben Carson, Hillary Clinton, you, it doesn't matter. The script is written. But let's also talk about something which is even more frightening. The level of surveillance that is happening in our country, in our world, that your children are going to now inherit. The level of surveillance remember, always look to the UK. When they sneeze, we catch a cold, the old expression. Right now, in the UK, they're having laws and provisions that allow the government to go in, Sid, and check your URL.
Yes.
Okay, so here is the typical American, okay, this is the prototypical kind of a, I don't care, I've got nothing to hide. As long as it helps us in our war against terror and ISIS, go ahead. I don't care. Doesn't bother me. What's the big deal? There is a generation right now who has no fear. You know, in Florida, and I'm a second-generation Floridian, you know that we have these signs, don't feed the crocodile, don't feed the alligators. Don't feed the alligators. Why? Because they're going to lose their fear of us. And they're going to start coming up on the banks and say, hey, how are you? Where's that food? Kids, we have lost our fear of surveillance. Absolutely. And it's not the government. It's not the Democrat. It's not the Republican. It's not Obama. It's this weird security surveillance apparatus that has taken us over. We are now absolutely immersed in a world of surveillance that we can't even imagine. And that's not being taken or talked about at all.
No, that very rarely.
No.
Well, George Orwell talked about it about 31 when he titled this book, I should say 1984. 60 seconds to go. Give me your theory. 60 seconds. I need your theory because I do respect it. What happened to the plane over Egypt?
Well, put it this way. Always go first for whatever the government says. Any government. That's the first. Remember, that's what they want me to think. Whatever any government says, that's the official story. I'm saying it's a little early. Don't be afraid of this so-called thing called the conspiracy theory. Because remember something, in our state of affairs, planes don't just blow up in the middle
right.
of the air.
That's they right.
Just don't.
Right.
I mean, that's pretty good. So just sit back. But ladies and gentlemen of the jury, please keep an eye very, very carefully on what is happening right now, this bellicose saber-rattling regarding us in Russian borders and the like. We do not want another Cold War. There was a time before you were here when we went crazy over Cuban missiles in Cuba, 90 miles from Miami. We went berserk. We were going to go into an actual full-scale nuclear conflagration. That is what NATO is doing now. That is what's happening right now. And our comprehension of Ukraine, Crimea, all of that is not even resembling reality. Sid, on behalf of a grateful nation, I want to thank you, not for what you do, but for what you appear to do. And I mean that sincerely.
I love you. There he is, Lionel, everybody. 19 minutes of radio gold. Nobody doesn't like Lionel. Nobody. He's man, is he smart, huh?
He's quick, man.
Yeah, he says a lot of things, and we don't know what he's talking about half the time because he's just so much smarter than we are. And it's amazing how many references, how many countries, how many leaders, historical references. He really is. He's a wonderful guest. He's a great guy, too. So I do want to thank Lionel very, very much. 844-640-6464. 844-640-6464. Lots more to do. Terrorism expert Max Abrams, former Washington Redskin quarterback and NFL analyst Joe Theismann, Tamara Holder, Fox News, and a host of others. Back on a busy Wednesday right after this.
Sid. Ralph, thank you. Well, the Clippers may have a very comfortable 13-point lead going into the second half, but as always, there are elements to improve on. I just finished talking with assistant coach Jim Ion and asked him what he liked, didn't like about that first half. He thought defensively the team started slowly not picking up Portland's dribble penetration, that is.
It's a Sid Rosenberg Show on 640 Sports right now.
You are certainly the biggest celebrity in the race. Nobody is questioning that. It's how it will translate into you as a leader, into you as a president. That's what the testing is about. However, these tactics have worked well for you. The question is, will they continue to? Yesterday, you were outspoken about how you thought Hillary Clinton had gotten a pass, only easy questions in the debate. Now, we both know you tweeted that you thought Anderson did a great job in the debate.
He did do a very good job.
He was
job.
The one asking the questions.
He did a terrific job.
So
but
how did you not get good questions
and
if
way,
he did a great job?
He had some tough questions, but they weren't tough like the questions that we were getting. And the questions that I was getting, it wasn't even a question from John Harwood. He was making wise guy statements with the questions.
Right, but that's one example from one guy.
He's a terrific person, by the way, and he asked him a question about me, and Governor Huckabee let him have it, and I thought he did a great job. So the difference is I thought Anderson Cooper did a great job, but comparison, and they were tough enough questions, but they weren't tough like us, and ours weren't even questions. But they were statements given over by the moderator.
I know, but Mr. Trump, can you imagine what would happen if he came out against Hillary Clinton? Here were his first questions. Will you say anything to get elected? Do you change your political identity based on who you're talking to? Are you a progressive or a moderate? He then looks at Bernie Sanders and says, is there anybody else here who's not a capitalist? And then starts to dictate what he says that the GOP made to go ad against him as a socialist who honeymooned in Russia. These were heavy blows that Anderson brought. He tested them. He showed what you want to see in a debate, which is, when I punch you in the nose, how do you respond? And this would be something you should embrace, right?
Well, the question is, did he talk about the emails in any great length? He asked Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders somehow gave her a pass. That was the end of Bernie Sanders.
Not Anderson Cooper. That was Bernie's judgment, not Coop's.
No. But did he ask? Did he go into the emails with Hillary during the question?
Sure, he did. Sure, he did his job. But this is about you guys, not about the media.
I understand that. There were other things. I mean, there were a lot of things that could have been asked of Hillary that could have been very nasty, so nasty that I don't even want to bring them up. But there were many things that could have asked. Now, with that being said, I thought Anderson was very professional. I thought he was tough. But if you look at the questions that were asked of us, they were much tougher than that.
Some Depeche Mode for our boss, Leo Baldwin. I love this song. Love it. Classic mode. Well, there's a knockout win for Chris Cuomo. And I hope Lauren and everybody else is listening, because once again, when pressed for an answer, your guy, Donald Trump, didn't have one. There are so many things out there that Anderson Cooper could have asked Hillary Clinton. So many. I can't even name one. He named one, the email. Great. We were over that. Anderson Cooper did ask him more than once. Bernie Sanders made his little kumbaya deal there. Leave her alone. Nobody cares. And when pressed by Chris Cuomo, just, hey, give me something else. There are so many things, so many places Anderson Cooper could have got. So many, I can't even talk about it.
I can.
It's the same. It's Donald Trump. He's done this a million times, saying, I have no idea what the answer is, so I'll yell and I'll scream and I'll exaggerate and I'll make it sound like it's the greatest, the biggest, the best, and I got dick. Dick! Chris Cuomo just kicked his ass. Just so you know, that piece of the Donald Trump interview literally was on live on CNN 30 minutes ago. And during my conversation with Lionel, Eric Langell, this is why he's the Fred Norris of Sports Talk Radio, Eric Langell ran tape on the CNN live Donald Trump interview. So you got that literally moments after it aired on television. And there's no other way. This is not up for debate. I'm not going to the scorecards here. This is not Howard Letterman. I got a 10-8. This was a knockout by Chris Cuomo.
Maybe. Okay. But Hillary's the same thing. She doesn't answer any questions either. She doesn't go anywhere.
We're not talking about Hillary.
I know, but I am. But those are the two candidates we have, Hillary or Trump.
No, we don't.
And they're both in the same boat.
No. The last poll I saw, the two candidates we have are Hillary and Ben Carson. Because last I saw, Donald Trump is second to Ben Carson. And by the way, Donald Trump would get killed by Hillary today, and Ben Carson would tie Hillary Clinton today. So if you want to be correct in your statistical analysis, the two candidates we have today are Hillary and Carson, not Donald Trump.
Well, there were questions that should have been asked. Why was Stevens in Benghazi?
Why couldn't Donald, where were the weapons going? I'm not asking you.
No, I'm just saying, but there were.
But how do you feel about the fact that this guy wants to be president, claims to be the best president, and you know the questions, and he doesn't?
No, he should have. I agree with you. There should be answers. He should have said, why was Stevens in Benghazi? Where did Gaddafi's weapons go?
Forget about that. It's still Benghazi. I think what Anderson Cooper was asking Donald Trump was, let's move off Benghazi. We know about that. Give me something else. Give me something else.
How women's wages went down when she was Secretary of State.
Right.
When she said women's rights, look at the records. Wages went down. Men prospered when she was Secretary of State. That's one reason. There's a few more. I'm just thinking off the cuff.
How about Anderson Cooper make Hillary Clinton run down what she accomplished as Secretary of State?
There you go.
But why wouldn't Donald Trump just say those things instead of him yelling, there are so many. He couldn't name one. There are so many. He couldn't name one.
You're right. Why not? Libya, fail. Syria, fail. The Israeli-Palestinian peace process, fail. She's failed in almost everything she's tried to do.
Let's get Roger Stone back on the air. How about that interview? Roger Stone ran through a
litany. That was awesome.
Roger Stone, who Donald Trump fired back in August, ran through a litany of things in his new book out. Some very, very scary.
He probably should have kept him around,
He could have learned some things.
Yes.
He could have learned something. I mean, Jesus Christ, Donald Trump. There are so many, I can't name one.
No, you're right. I'm getting annoyed with the so many.
Oh,
I'm the greatest. You just wait.
I'll show you. GT Mike, good morning, Michael.
You know, Sid, it trips me out that now all of a sudden people are coming around and realizing that there's no substance about Trump. I mean, all the whole time, you have a guy that just gets up there and wants to be braggadocious, wants to go ahead and talk about everything that he's going to make great, but actually doesn't give you anything to tell you how he's going to make it great. I think it's kind of funny, man. You know, it's so open right now about whoever's going to be there and whoever's going to run. But to see a guy that's doing what he's doing, has no substance to add, can't even ask questions, don't even know the question, can't ask questions because he doesn't know the answers to the questions. You know, you ask him anything about foreign policy or about anything about outside of our country, he doesn't know anything. He comes out with stuff and says, we're going to make America better, and the things that they're printing on it are printed in China. So it's like, it trips me out when you see people like this. Hey, I'm going to make things better, but don't do what I did. Don't use the tactics that I did to make a lot of money. We can't do that no longer. Come on, man. He's been going ahead and dealing with China, all his stuff that he puts out, nothing's made here, and now all of a sudden he's going to make us better? How did it make us better? By doing those things before, man. So just let him keep doing what he's got to do. He's just a blowhole. He's got nothing to say. He's got a big, big mouth, and I'm glad that things are happening like that. Take it easy, bro.
Thank you, GT Mike. Mario Salerno, our favorite New Jersey listener, who listens every single day and Facebooks us throughout the show. He's become one of our really, really good buddies. And his brother works at Tijuana Platts, which the good news is does not give you E. coli like Chipotle. Very good news.
That is good news.
Yes. He is on a Facebook tear here. He has been calling Hillary every name in the book. Stuff I wouldn't even say on the air. Yes. The C word, and I don't mean cancer.
Oh, my Lord.
I know, horrible.
You can't say that on the air.
You can't say that?
Not between 6 and 7.
Right.
The kid's in the car.
After 9 o'clock at night, it's fine.
Yeah.
Here's Fish. Good morning, Fish.
Listen, Trump will get the job done. That's what you people don't realize. You want to pitter-patter with all this talk? All these politicians have been talking for years, and nothing's been done. Let's make a change. You know, Obama, Obamacare, all this crap. Nothing happened. No jobs, no bridges fixed. Trump will get it done because that's what he does. He fixes properties, okay? Look at his properties. Go around and see if there's any flaws in his properties. That's what he'll do for the United States. He ain't talking, man. This guy's not a talker. He gets it done.
All right. Fish says he gets it done.
Now, I got to say, the Trump Hotel in Vegas is the only one you can't smoke in.
That's right.
And it's very nice.
No, it's a gorgeous hotel. Of all the places I've stayed there, that Trump International, my suite specifically.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that.
That was ridiculous.
That was insane.
Why did I get that?
They like you at HBO.
I had like a two-bedroom suite. It was...
No. You had like a two-bedroom apartment. I had a suite. I had a damn apartment. I mean, literally, the rooms were separated. I mean, it was... You had your own kitchen.
I've never stayed in a room like that anywhere ever.
That was insane.
Not in Rome, not in Paris, not in London, not in New York City. I've never stayed in a room like that.
That was insane.
It was crazy.
I got to say, it was really nice.
What fight was that?
That was Marquez Bradley. It was very nice to walk around a hotel in Vegas and not have cigarette smoke, or people burning you with their cigarettes because they're too damn drunk and they're not paying attention where they're walking.
You and I had breakfast there, my hotel, every morning.
Yep.
And if I remember correctly, I had to leave on a Saturday morning.
You did.
Danielle
was running the marathon.
No. That was the... Oh, you're right. Danielle was running the Chicago Marathon. So I left because I stayed at the Trump, but we did the shows at the Wynn. So I had to come home Friday so she can go to Chicago and run the marathon on Sunday. So you cried, if I remember correctly. You were crying because I was leaving. You
We had lunch like 3 days in breakfast.
Right.
3 days in a row in the same place, same exact table.
And, same exact table. It's very romantic.
And then I went the next day and had breakfast there alone in the same table.
Oh, really? God.
Oh, that's horrible.
Even the same waitress was like, where's your guy? I'm like, oh, come on.
Where's
really?
Your
you
guy?
Gotta do that?
What are you kidding me?
Well, what?
She thought we were gay like
no,
in Chelsea?
No, just like, no, like, well, maybe she
are
did
you
actually.
Gay?
You made it like into a very nice Warren Beatty movie just now.
Maybe she did. I don't know. I just thought she meant like my coworker.
Waiting for
my boss.
The scene with Meg Ryan in
Sleepless in Seattle.
Yeah, yeah. You guys can.
I actually went to a Warren Beatty and his wife, Annette Bening, at the Empire State Building. They both met at the Empire State Building in both of those movies, right? Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan.
Yes.
Sleepless in Seattle.
Yes.
And then what was the name? Was it an affair or what was it? It was a great movie.
That
Beatty and Bening. It was a remake, too. I forget. Richard, good morning. How are you?
Hey, what's going on, Sid? How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
Doing good. Hey, I just want to talk about Bush's failing campaign.
You talk about Jeb Bush?
Yeah.
Jeb Bush did come out yesterday, I should say, and apologize to the French because he did make a remark to Marco Rubio last week asking if, in fact, to work a 3-day work week like they do in France. So Jeb Bush had to come out yesterday to add more insult and embarrassment to his ridiculous campaign and apologize to the French. How about that?
Yeah, I saw it. That's when Rubio put him in his place right after.
Yes, he did.
But I just want to make the quick what I find interesting is that his campaign manager is very opposite of how he is in attitude. I mean, Danny Diaz is a very high energy, he's a very high energy person. He's gung-ho about a lot of things, and I think that's what's making his campaign fail. You know, that attack that he did on Rubio might have sounded great had it came from somebody else, somebody who is far more direct and somebody who is actually, you know, as childish as it sounds, somebody who's meaner. You know, Jeb Bush is a nice guy, and that's why I think it came out really awkward. Maybe had it been Danny Diaz who had said that little line, maybe it would have sounded, you know, a lot better.
Yeah.
But I think that's why his campaign is failing. I think if his senior advisor was his campaign manager, who was originally supposed to be his campaign manager, I think he'd be doing a lot better because, you know, they align more closely in terms of attitude and how they are. So I'm a Rubio supporter, but I just thought, you know, that was a good good little take right there.
All right. Thank you, Richard. Thank you for that. Larry Lawton is going to come in tomorrow. I'll call in tomorrow. Everybody knows who Larry Lawton is.
Love Larry.
Yes. A great what a way to turn your life around. This Reality Check program is helping thousands of kids all over the world. He's been on the Today Show a million times, CNN, you name it. For a while there, he was one of the top earners in the Gambino crime family. He stole jewelry. And at one point, he estimates he stole upwards of about $18 million worth of jewelry. I believe he served 11 years in a state penitentiary. And anytime there's like the prison break a couple of months ago with those two guys up in New York. And
Matt and Sweat.
Very good. Very good. Anytime these stories come out, he seems to be the go-to guy. He's got a book out. It's a wonderful book, a New York Times bestseller. Peter Goldenbecker writes a lot of Yankee books, wrote the book along with Larry Lawton. And he's a great guest. And he'll be live in studio tomorrow. He's got something
he's
going on.
He's coming in studio?
Bowling event.
He's coming here?
Well, he may call. I don't know.
Okay, all right, cool. Either way,
Last time he came into studio with the hot psychologist.
She won.
Lisa Palmer, I think. She was Miss Vermont.
For Donald Trump's.
Yeah,
she has pictures
of her and Donald Trump. Donald Trump grabbing her ass or something. I don't know. Not that Donald would ever do that, of course. He's very presidential these days. You'd never see Donald Trump. I mean, never, right? I mean, he's presidential.
If there's one thing he's never been accused of, it's a womanizer.
Never. Not Donald Trump.
No.
Max Abrams, terrorism expert, will stop by. Former Redskin quarterback, NFL analyst Joe Theismann will stop by. Terry Collins gets a 2-year contract extension after managing the Mets to the World Series. The Heat lose last night to Atlanta. The Knickerbockers in Cleveland tonight, taking on LeBron James and the Cavaliers. The Panthers, home ice losers to Boston on Friday and Washington on Saturday, start a 2-day road trip in California tonight, in Anaheim tonight, in San Jose coming up tomorrow, and week 9 already. Super Bowl in San Francisco right around the corner. Week 9 of the NFL starting tomorrow with the Bengals still unbeaten and the Browns. And news is, Johnny Manziel will play quarterback for the Browns tomorrow night. 844-640-6464. Back right after this.